afternoon. On behalf of the family, just want to thank each of you for coming. And today, as we gather to grieve and to remember and honor Danny's life, words are profoundly inadequate to bring comfort to our troubled hearts. And there is no replacement for a husband, father, brother, co-worker, friend, and all that Danny's been to each one of us. I first met Danny, and we were talking about it earlier, almost 30 years ago, and I really start to feel old now. There were some things that left an indelible impression on my life from Danny that I want to share with you. He was like a big brother to me, and when I first met him, I was 16, and he did not have to treat me like he did. But he treated me with incredible kindness. He tried unsuccessfully to get me hooked on the game of golf. Despite his best efforts, it never took. But he taught me a lot about etiquette. I can handle myself well on the greens, but I can't do anything beyond that. But he tried. He was patient enough to teach me, and he did get me after moving from Pennsylvania as a teenager. He got me hooked on ACC basketball. Although this team that wears sky blue never took either. So I know I was a disappointment for him in that regard. But in 1998, he did something that changed the course of my life. He hired me as his helper to work with him at Gainwell. And I didn't know it then, but that decision would ultimately change the direction of my life and enable me to take care of my large-sized family. I never had any intention of getting into construction, and he talked me into it, and the appeal to me was to be able to work with him. So I had known him for several years at that point. And I got to work with his Uncle Harold, who became one of my favorite people. And Harold told me when I first started working, when I was having a tough time keeping up with Danny, his energy was unbelievable. And in trying to keep up with him, Harold said, "Danny, just stand still. Danny will be back around in 2 minutes." He had an incredible work ethic. And I had seen that working with him on various projects. But when he hired me, I got to see it up close and personal. And Danny had a drive to take care of his family. And he worked hard and was a great example for me. He brought that work ethic to his ministry as a deacon at Grace Reformed Baptist Church. And if my dad were here today, he would tell you how appreciative he was of Danny's loyalty, his faithfulness, and how he brought that same ethic in his service to the Lord. He was a great example to me. And I can't thank them enough. As each of you think about the impact of Danny on your life, I want to share some scripture. I promise Pam I would keep it under an hour. I will do my best. But I want to share some brief thoughts with you today and hopefully provide a measure of encouragement for you. From a passage I found 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, it says this: "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." There are two things that I want to point out about that passage, and a lot more could be taken from it. But first of all, the scripture describes God as the Father of mercies. Here is both good news and bad news for us. First of all, the bad news. Mercy is God holding back what we deserve? The fact that Scripture reminds us and tells us that He is a God of mercy reminds us that we are in desperate need of mercy. And this is truth that I desperately need. Mercy is God holding back what I deserve. And I'm not here to tell you how rotten a sinner you are today. Scripture does that for us. And God is our judge. In Psalm 51, David says this, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, and you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." I have never had to teach any one of our children to disobey, to beat up on his or her sibling, to steal a toy away from them. And why is that? We as parents teach our children to do right because they inherently know how to do wrong, don't they? It's in our nature. Ecclesiastes 7:20 says that surely there is not a righteous man on earth who does good and never sins. The problem goes a bit deeper than just our actions. And Jesus said in Matthew 15, verses 19 and 20, "For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man." And inevitably, with sin comes death. We are surrounded by death. It touches every one of us. Mr. Strickland and I were just talking about that. It comes for each one of us. For some of it, it comes quickly and surprises us. I was at a funeral less than 3 weeks ago for my cousin, who was a lifelong professional landscaper, got on his lawnmower that morning to cut grass and was killed in an awful accident. When he started that day, he had no plans to leave this world. For some of us, it takes us by surprise. For some, like Danny, it's a long and arduous and painful road of suffering. We can do everything we can to ignore it, to put it off for another day. In positive ways, we try to take care of ourselves. We diet, or we try. We exercise. We self-improve. We spend billions of dollars on health products and beauty products, all to put off what we know is inevitable and what is coming for each one of us. We try to come to terms with death, sometimes in negative ways. We've seen people try to drown it, numb it, do everything they can to forget about it, but it always pursues us. We look in the mirror every day and we have more gray hair than the day before, and it's a grim reminder that the wages of sin is death, and we must all pay. Ecclesiastes 8, verse 8 says, "No man has power to retain the spirit or power over the day of death." Try as we might, it is not in our power or our control. If it was, we'd plan for it. In Romans 5:12, Paul says this, "Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all have sinned." What is the payment for our sin? Well, the scripture reminds us in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is what? Death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We know this. The scripture describes God as holy and righteous. He is an uncompromising judge. And while we look at a passage in 2 Corinthians that I just read where it describes him as the Father of mercies, God will not compromise his holiness. He is a righteous judge. If someone in your family was hurt or harmed, and the perpetrator stood before a trial of his peers, and the jury said guilty, and the judge turned around and said, I'm going to let you go. What would your opinion of that judge be? You'd rightfully be angry. God is a just judge, and he will not grade us on a curve. He does not compare our sin like we do to the person that I'm sitting next to. I know I'm a better person than that person. God doesn't see us that way. The scripture concludes us all under sin so that he can be righteous when he declares us guilty. And if we stopped there, it'd be bad news. It would be hopeless. But there is life-changing, death-defying good news that scripture gives us. In John chapter 3 and verse 36, it says, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey, the wrath of God remains on him. Ephesians 2, 4 and 5, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. Another one, Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. This is mercy. God holds back what I deserve. He took the wrath that I deserved and placed it on his Son in my place so that I could have the righteousness of his Son placed on me. This is the essence of the gospel. We call it the great exchange. My sin for his righteousness. Proverbs 28:13 says, whoever conceals his transgressions will not prosper, but he who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy. So what do we do? I was reading through the Gospels and was reminded of the man who was born blind. And he sees, well, he doesn't see Jesus coming. He hears the commotion of Jesus coming and he cries out, Jesus, have mercy on me. If the thought occurs to you today that you may walk out of here and not live past the end of this day, and you are not right with God, cry out to him. Scripture gives us precedence. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, what? Shall be saved. He is faithful. Some of us will call God our judge. But some of us, as forgiven sinners, can call him our Father, our Redeemer. Paul says it in Galatians 3, verse 4, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Because of God's mercy, his grace applied to our lives, we can go from a sinner rightfully deserving the wrath of God to being called his heir. An heir of eternal life, where death does not have to hold power over our lives. We do not have to live in fear of it. Because the scripture says, the second point in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 is that he is the Father of mercies. He is also a God of comfort. And no amount of words that we can say this afternoon can bring comfort. Nothing we can say can make us feel better. The only thing I know to do to encourage you today is to point you to the God of comfort. He comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. He is the God of comfort. The word comfort there is the word paraclete in the Greek. And it means this: he puts his arm around us and picks us up and carries us through that suffering, that affliction, that pain. God, nowhere in Scripture, and I know this is popular amongst a lot of preachers today, but God, nowhere in Scripture promises us, his children, a life without suffering, without pain, a life that is easy, a life with no hardship and no affliction, but he does promise us that he will be with us. He is the paraclete. He will come alongside of us, put his arm around us, and take us through the pain. Because of that, Paul says in Romans chapter 5, verse 3, not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings. Think about that. Knowing that suffering produces endurance. He said further in Philippians 3, 8, indeed I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may obtain, or that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith. And then he says again in verse 10, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. We spend a lot of time asking the question, why? Why did I have to go through this? Why did our loved ones have to go through this? Well, I can tell you I don't have all the answers, but I know who does. And his word is clear. He takes us through suffering so that as his children, we get to experience what it means for him to be our comforter and to know him in a much more deeper and meaningful way than we ever would have if we had a life of ease. For those that are promising you that, they're selling you short. And they probably want their money. Pam told me when we spoke the other day, she prayed a very specific prayer when all this started with Danny some 13 years ago. The last few years being the worst, and she prayed that God would draw her close to him and that he would deepen her relationship and her knowledge of him in the middle of the suffering. And he answered her prayer. For the believer, there is purpose in pain. It's not meaningless. For the unbeliever, there is no sense of it. But God says he takes us through so that we might encourage and comfort those with the same comfort that we have been comforted with. Lastly, I want to encourage you with one more thought. Dementia is an awful thing. But I want you to know this, for the believer, dementia, Alzheimer's, or any disease, or any form of suffering in this life cannot separate us from the love of God. Take that home with you. If you are a child of God today, don't let fear reside in your heart because you're afraid you may forget your Lord. Because I'll tell you this, he will not forget you. Romans 8, 35 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Guess what? Dementia fits right in there. There is no disease that can separate us from the love of God. Paul says this, I am sure of this, that he who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Rest in that. Take comfort in that. Words fail. We certainly fail. But God has never failed. And if you can call him today the Father of Mercies, you can rest in that comfort that he promises to give as he comes alongside of us and takes us through the pain of losing our loved ones and saying goodbye to them. The same comfort is available to any that will ask him for it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that through Christ, death and hell has been conquered on our behalf. Lord, I pray today, as we contemplate how fragile our own lives are, Father, that none of us would leave here and just move on to the next thing. I pray the weight of this moment might weigh on minds of those who have not yet been convinced that you are the only way. Father, I pray for any that have not, that they would cry out to you for mercy, that you would be to them a merciful Father and not a righteous judge. Lord, for this family, I pray that you would be their sustaining grace, that you will do for them what only you can do, that you will pick them up, wrap your arms around them and carry them. And Father, that your grace would be seen by those that are watching, that you would be glorified. We know that precious in your eyes is the death of your saints. And we know that you give sustaining grace as we grieve, and we ask for that today. In the name of our Savior, amen.
Truth can calm the troubled soul. to the grave, what shall we say? Christ, he lives, Christ, he lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him, there we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death
you for that. We would have no hope in and of ourselves apart from the mighty work of our Savior. Lord, I ask that we would rest in that today. That would be our solace and our comfort. So we know that death could not conquer you. You conquered it, and you have done the same on our behalf for all of your children. I pray today, Lord, that those that have ears to hear would hear. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
truck.
Just standing. We're gonna.